So you describe the success of AirAsia, the story of AirAsia, as a perfect example of what the ASEAN region can do for a business and for businessmen like you. But I imagine that there are challenges. I mean, AirAsia has seen some challenges over the years. Can you also draw parallelism with what ASEAN is experiencing?
Sure, I mean, look, any business will have challenges. Any new opportunity will have challenges. I saw the opportunity of ASEAN. Of course, it hasn't been plain sailing, but we've gone from 200,000 to 73 million in 16 years, passengers that is, from two planes to 200 planes. And it's on the back of me believing in ASEAN. Lots more to do, and the challenges we face are really nationalism more than anything. People are looking at, well, should I protect my individual country as opposed to look at ASEAN? And the incumbents are always the problem. So that is actually AirAsia's challenge, and that is ASEAN's challenge as well. Mm-hmm. Whether to put aside vested interests, put people first, and look at the greater good of a common market. Mm-hmm. So actually, the question is brilliant, and I'm going to use it from now on. The parallels are quite similar, but we're making progress. We're making progress and showing that, you know, it makes much more sense to act as one. We've been campaigning to own 100% of all our ASEAN airlines. It'll make us more efficient, it'll reduce our cost, and hence we can create more jobs. So those are things that ASEAN also is still grappling with, so the similarities are uncanny.
But nationalism seems to make sense. I mean, for a Filipino, Philippines first. For Trump, USM first.
Yeah, well, I don't agree with that.
Why not?
Let's take a Filipino e-commerce young business, or a new internet startup. He can have 100 million people in the Philippines, but he could have 700 million people in ASEAN to sell to build his business around. Compare that with who he has to compete with, Alibaba, that has 1 billion people in China. That's why they've grown so quickly. There is no way a Filipino company or a Malaysian company or an Indonesian company can compete with the scale of China unless they start looking at a bigger market such as ASEAN. You compare the success of Grab taxi fighting Uber. Uber is a huge mammoth, but Grab has given them a really good fight based out of ASEAN. They're in Philippines, they're in Malaysia, they're in Indonesia, they're in Thailand, and so on and so forth. So there's a perfect example. If Grab was only in the Philippines, Uber would have wiped them out by now.
But with bigger market comes bigger competition. Do you think, like, smaller companies are starting to worry, maybe the giants from overseas will eat us up?
Well, look at AirAsia. I had two planes 16 years ago.
That is true.
Against Malaysian Airlines, 120 planes. Mm-hmm. Singapore Airlines, 130 planes. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we're a great example of ASEAN. We're a great example of a small entrepreneur with a little bit of a dream, four of us going and doing something. So if we can do it, anyone can. And the airline business is a very, very tough business. I was going to use some wrong words there.
Okay, and earlier this year we had a chat and you did say that instead of expanding your footprint in the US or UK, you want to focus on ASEAN. You want to focus on Southeast Asia. In fact, you want to consolidate your Southeast Asian units into
yes.
one holding company.
Correct.
When's that going to happen?
Well, that depends on what you on ASEAN and the leaders of ASEAN. We're putting together a group structure. So there'll be AirAsia Group, and they will own the various airlines now, including the Malaysian operation. And hopefully in time, we'll persuade the ASEAN leadership to create this ASEAN community airline and be a precursor to many, many other ASEAN brands. I see light, but you know, until the fat lady sings, who knows?
So you currently have 200 aircraft in your fleet, 400 orders on the books?
About 300 more to go.
How many passengers do you fly every year? All your
73 million.
73 million.
At the moment. And, you know, as I said at the beginning of the interview, we started with 200,000 passengers. So that should give new entrepreneurs in ASEAN motivation.
And what kind of growth are you seeing over the next 3 to 5 years?
Well, the ball is in our court. We're in a fantastic space. We have India and China. We have 700 million people in ASEAN. The potential to grow is up to us. And for me, the growth is not in Manila or Jakarta. It's in developing secondary and tertiary cities, giving connectivity and economic growth and passengers to those secondary and tertiary cities, connecting ASEAN from Cebu to Jakarta, or Cebu to Surabaya, Phuket to Boracay. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of what I'm focusing on. Rather than go stretch ourselves too thin, we'll do the odd route to Europe, we'll do the odd route to America, but really my goal is to open up routes in Southeast Asia and Asia that I've never had connectivity before.
Mm-hmm. Do you have a target, like how many percent increase in passenger traffic?
Oh no, I'm not good at targets. We just grow as quick as we can. You know, and as sensibly as we can. There's no point growing and screwing it up. And there's so many macro factors outside. You know, anyone who says, oh, we're going to grow at this, is really just taking a guess. Might as well go down to the casino downstairs. But I think we're in a good position to grow. I think all the building blocks are there. And I think Philippines is our jewel in the crown. It's been very tough in here. The incumbents made it a tough entry for us, mm-hmm. but I always think, you know, having more competition is better, and we're doing things that the other two aren't doing, so we're very excited.
You mentioned local carriers here in Manila. You know, the two that we have, Cebu Pacific and Philippine Airlines, their parent companies are venturing into airports. They're, you know, wanting to get into the infrastructure space, which pretty much makes perfect sense. It's like a perfect fit. Is AirAsia thinking of doing
No, I think we focus on airlines, but we will work with big supporters of private entrepreneurs owning airports. I said it on stage yesterday. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, if we wait for governments all the time, we could be waiting forever. So I'm a big supporter of that, and good luck to them. But we would provide entrepreneurs an opportunity that they know that AirAsia is coming in. So their investment is kind of covered. But for us, we should focus on what we do best, which is moving people from A to B and selling as much ancillary income to them.
And from budget airlines, making travel more affordable for everyone, you've got shared economy, Airbnb, also making, you know, this traveling experience so much different. You're changing the landscape, really. What's next, do you think? I know you're a visionary. What do you see as going to be the next game changer for this industry?
Well, I mean, I think finally you're getting airlines realizing what their market is. Mm-hmm. You know, I think airlines tried to do everything before, from first class to economy, from turboprop to an A380. Mm-hmm. And I think now people are beginning to see, when you see what SIA is doing and Qatar, they're focusing more on the front end. And you're getting more long-haul, low-cost carriers. I think short-haul, full-service airlines will have to improve their product, because people are going to say, well, why should I travel on a full-service airline if the low cost is just as good? So I think you're going to get that market separation. I think the second innovation I see is technology is going to change a passenger's experience. I hope in years there'll be an ASEAN e-gate system that recognizes your face and lets you through, as opposed to standing hours and hours and hours in queues for, you know, I hope there's an ASEAN visa. I think in future there'll be a permanent bag tag. You'll be able to order your food from your seat with your plane, with your phone, as opposed to waiting for the trolley to come down. I think technology is very exciting, and I think the aviation industry is in a great place to benefit from it. So brand separation and technology are the two things.
Exciting times. Tony, I know last month you launched your memoir, Flying High.
Oh, yeah.
Where you talked about your experience, your education in the UK, you're starting out in the music business, and then working with the likes of Richard Branson before getting into the airline business.
Yeah.
But there was one quote in particular that struck me, and you said that Asian leaders tend to overstay, and that you believe that a great leader must know when to quit. You just got married. Is this you slowing down?
Well, I kind of said in the book that I'm going to slow down. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I'm not going to retire anytime soon. There's a little bit to do now. But I do think that I mustn't overstay. A good leader knows when to go. But more importantly, put a succession plan in that takes the company even further. I would be a failed leader if someone else comes in and the company doesn't do as well. So I'm very mindful of that. I'm very mindful to know when to go. It's not quite time yet, but that time is approaching, and we're working on a succession plan.
Until that day comes, thank you very much. Good luck.
Thanks a lot. Cheers.
Thank you, Tony.
Thanks for the interview.
Thank you.